Worldview. When the Q&A is over, please stay seated. Lily is very pregnant, and they have to be somewhere right after this, so just trying to give everyone some space. I would really appreciate it. Thank you. And now that I've said all that, I should probably tell you my name is Janelle Riley. I'm an editor at Variety. Thank you so much for joining us for this SAG NomCom Q&A with the Tender Bar. I love this movie so much. And at this time, I'm so thrilled to welcome today's guests from the film. They are simply two of the best actors working today. Please welcome Lily Rabe and Ben Affleck.
I did a lot of local stuff that was non-union. I didn't know that was bad. I don't know if I'm supposed to say that, but I didn't even know. I actually did a TV series that was non-union as a little kid, and they totally exploited me, which is why I really believe in SAG. Actually, it's and then I was also did, once I got a lot of extra work, non-union extra work, and it was so much better to be an extra, obviously, once I was in SAG. SAG members in Boston, before there were so many movies coming to Massachusetts, like this one, but we were extras in a movie that, The Good Mother with Diane Keaton, and we were extras in Field of Dreams, and we were extras in a Carl Malden, like, what was it called, PBS Playhouse, that show they had. Anyway, got to see a lot of famous people from very far away.
I just want to be clear, they were applauding your endorsement of SAG.
Yes. Absolutely, I really do.
So here we are now with the Tender Bar, which is it's such a beautiful story, and I know it's obviously based on the memoir by J.R. Moriarty. Were you familiar at all with the book when the script came its way to you, and what interested you in the roles? Let's start with Lily.
I hadn't read the book, and I did as soon as I read the script first, and then I read the book. I felt he's such a beautiful writer, and I loved something I think that exists in both the adaptation and in the book. Both are written with such restraint. There's so much wonderful stillness, and there's also incredible humor that I found sort of this wonderful and very unique balance of the humor and the sort of drama and the pain of the story. And yeah, so I thought the writing sort of across the board was just uniquely so compelling and
specifically, what interested you in Dorothy, other than it's the role you were offered? But she's such a, like,
I auditioned.
Did you really?
You did too, right?
Of course.
I made a tape. It was like right before the holidays, I made a self tape, maybe two scenes. But then it was very fast. It was George, I think he's like a very solid, quick decision maker, or at least I like to tell myself that. But it felt very quick. Sometimes you sort of do these self tapes and you send them into the ether and you don't hear anything from us, or you never hear anything, but it was like very quick. And I fell so in love with her resilience. I found so, there are so many stories about with single mothers that, and I guess this could have, but I never found that there was any kind of self-pity or victimization. Her circumstances are her circumstances, and they certainly could be better, and she gets knocked down, but she really does just pick herself back up in such a uniquely wonderful way, and I wanted to play that. I wanted to be that woman and mother.
And then you've worked with George Clooney as a producer. What was it like working with him as an actor? Did you really audition?
You're still my boss. I was a producer too, by the way. I have to tell myself. I love George. He's great, you know. And I actually, Clea Duvall, who is a very close friend of mine, an old friend, gave me the book a long time ago. I was like, when Kim was like, you would love this book, and I read it and really liked it, and then just sort of never thought about it again. And then randomly, I was in Cuba, and I got this, like, and it was very difficult to get, like, happening the internet and stuff, and I kept on getting this one random number, and you know, eventually I went to a place, checked my email, like, George, just trying to get in touch with you, wants to do this movie.
You were ghosting George Clooney?
Not on purpose. But he wasn't happy. Hey dude, did you get my text? Chill! he likes to get responded to. So. I don't imitate George, don't tell me about it. And so he sent me this the script, and it all came back to me, and I was like, my gosh, what a great role, and what a great, and I wanted to work with him as a director so much, and the writing was so terrific, and such a great adaptation, Bill Monahan did, but I think George had a lot of work on it as well, and it was wonderful, and I can't believe you auditioned, because you're so good, you're the best thing in the movie, so.
What if for some actors say that they actually like to audition because they feel that they won the role and no one's going to fire them when they get there?
I got fired when I auditioned.
Did you really?
It was sort of a different, like, it's a sort of combination and amalgam, a little bit like that guy, but because tweaking the ages, and there's so many incredible kind of characters in the book, there's a little bit of kind of cross-pollination of stuff. And, you know, the thing is, I'm very, very research-based. I always don't feel like I'm imaginative enough. I feel like I have to know what is the thing, who is the person, and spent a lot of time doing that. And then in this thing, it was so richly detailed and written and so wonderfully told, and George had such a specific idea that I kind of, the thing about memoirs is they're not really the truth.
Yeah.
You know, they're actually how you remember it, or the portrait you're painting of a life. And so I thought, like, I don't want to look back at who the real person is, because that actually could be a distraction. I have everything I need here in this story to tell this memory of it, this version of it. And sometimes you even, like, I even, I don't know that I would have even read the book had I not already read it, because the script was so full. Like, it's just such great writing. This, the great, like, secret about acting is, you know, the same actor is, you know, terrible and one thing great and another thing because they have a great director, a great script. I mean, it so makes so much a difference, makes such a big difference. And in this case, I felt like I didn't even want to let anything else enter my sort of mind. I thought, this is it, I get it, I know what I'll do.
Did you ever meet Charlie, though? Because he's got to be pretty stoked Ben Affleck's
no.
him. Never, even to this day. Wow.
I met George.
In addition to the two of you, this movie has such a fantastic ensemble, and I want to start with the young actor who plays the young J.R., Daniel Ranieri.
Oh.
He is...
So.
And you know, kids, they can't lie when you're on set with them. What is it like working with someone? I know he had no experience prior to this role. Do you end up learning things from him sometimes when you're working with him?
Yeah, well, that's how I feel about just being with children. You're just you're just learning, and relearning all the things that you've forgotten and shouldn't forget. And so it was kind of the same way with Daniel. And then watching him with George was so beautiful because he was really getting this kind of masterclass from George for, you know, standing on your mark or whatever. Like, Daniel didn't know any of it. And just having George sort of give him this permission over and over again to be free, to follow his instincts. Was like the greatest thing to be around. And Daniel is wide open. He's like, and that's how I feel about Ben too. It's like, you're just opposite.
Very childlike.
There's just an openness and a curiosity, and everything gets in, and everything, there's nothing blocking the sort of like airwaves of creativity and of storytelling. And so it was really so wonderful to have that around all the time.
And apparently he was discovered on Jimmy Kimmel Live?
Yeah, he did it. He
didn't have to audition either.
Oh, that's not true. Yeah, he you know, like, he was, had this phenomenon of going viral happened to him because his mother recorded him. He's like, he's from Benson Hurst, and he's very real, and his mother recorded him, this fucking pandemic is fucking bullshit, fuck this pandemic. And he's just a little kid, you know, funny. And then Kimmel saw that and brought him on, like, what are you doing, swear, you know. And George saw that, and he's so self-evidently authentic and real. And I think having been a child actor and an actor as an adult, I really think that it's two totally distinct kinds of acting, sort of as Lily alluded to. And it was a really strange transition for me to make. It took me a while to figure out, oh, this is a whole different thing. Because as a child, you know, and I really have real feelings about child actors and being on set, having done it myself and having known what is healthy and wonderful about it and what isn't. You know, but to be good, as Lisa said, like, you don't want to have the kid know their marks and their lines and have rehearsed it and be very, you know, sort of the classic Oscar Mayer commercial kid, right, where there's, you know, the little alien sort of, you want someone just like completely authentic and have access to just, you know, able to just live realistically without any sense of anxiety or nervousness or self-consciousness. And he didn't have to do any work creating a character because who he is so authentically that person. And often what happens is that, I think, with children is that if they develop it, that the relationship that Lily cultivated with him and worked on and made him feel so safe and welcome and at home and comfortable is why you get that performance, because he's not acting at all. He knows his lines, and he's not old enough to let all this other stuff that gets in our heads interfere with any of that stuff. He can just easily transfer that because she's so good and real. It's just, that's how I felt. I guess, you know, you want a good director because that you can have that anchor, but then they say action, and you're kind of at sea if you don't really, you know, or you can be, you know, you be rowing your boat and they can and then get on. Oh, where do I go now? And that was the thing about Lily. I mean, this would be so easy and wonderful. Is like just like choose to anchor. I swim toward her. Whatever she's doing, that's good. I'll stick with this. I'll follow this around the scene. And I think the same experience was true for Daniel. And I also tried to cultivate. He is my son's age, and I'm at a point in life where I just really has to be important enough and meaningful enough for me to not be around my kids, as it's the most important, significant part of my life is being a father. And I miss them very much, and so I had this intense transference of connection from, you know, from my son who I was missing, who was having a hard time with me being away, to Daniel. You know, we got very close in the way that Lily did, and I think that helped him, but he just has a natural, you know, gift as well.
I actually spoke to Daniel, and he did say that he was intimidated at first because you were Batman.
It shouldn't seem to. Fuck you! I don't care if you're Batman. Fuck you, George Clooney. Yeah, two Batman sounds.
I didn't think about that.
Yeah, no, he's actually he would curse a lot because he had kind of gotten rewarded for that by getting attention. And his parents were sweet and funny and great, and but he didn't seem intimidated. He just had that natural gift of being like, it's, you know, 90% of acting. Found is just being comfortable. Unless you be comfortable and relaxed and at home with yourself and able to be, you know, then all of a sudden you can just sort of feel the feelings and have these experiences. And he had that ability. I don't know what it is. You know, he just seemed at ease. He said action on the set and didn't do that thing that it so often does, which makes you feel like, okay, acting time, you know, time to pretend, and it just kills it.
Well, the whole ensemble really does feel like a family, and I always think it's odd to throw actors together who may have never even met and say, okay, pretend you've known each other your entire lives. You have Christopher Lloyd playing your father. This whole group, you all work so well together. Did that sort of happen naturally? I don't know if you two knew each other before this. Really?
No, but I was thrilled. And this is real. Lily's amazing. George can't let me know that she's really good, dude, so don't fuss up. She's okay, all right. And she was. And it really was the thing that the... You know, I felt like I was going to have to be, you know, in some ways responsible for the other actor. You never really know. Some young actors, you know, they roll or the kid's not aware, or you just repeat the lines to them. There's all kinds of techniques. But I really knew that it had to be connected to Lily. It was really about her. And so it was so wonderful. She was just so fabulous and easy and lovely and such a kind person, too. I found if you're really lucky as an actor, you get to work with really wonderful people, other talented people are also wonderful.
Yeah.
It makes such a difference. People are smart and engaging and lovely and kind and caring. It just, I love it. And I find life is too short for like the other thing. Like, I don't care if you're good. Like, if you're going to be an asshole, like, you know, I'll do something else. You know? And it was the opposite of that. It's like enriching and thoughtful and sympathetic. So, you know, I felt like you were my friend for years already.
I felt that way too. And also very funny. George and Ben are very funny, which is great because we had all been sort of, it was like in the height of COVID too. And so I feel like you always have this incredible feeling of gratitude and this sort of preciousness of that time between action and cut, because no matter what, no matter how fast your director is, and George was so fast and not fussy, and our DP was so fast, but still it's like this, those lightning and bottle moments between action and cut, and then even more so because it was the height of this time, and it felt just so precious, and it was so easy to fall in love with my family making, and I got to fall in love with two sons, and then with Ben, who I think, you know, for the movie, he is for her the anchor. He's without him just sort of being on the planet, so even when she goes off and they are away, it's like she has to know that he's still walking the earth for her to be able to take a breath in the morning. And I just, to have that feeling with this human, this actor, was like just the easiest.
It's so authentic. It really reminded me of my relationship with my brother, except I'm the Charlie in this situation, if that makes sense. So I was really, really drawn into it. This movie is set largely in the 1970s, and I'm not even sure
I was like, do I look like I'm close in age to Lily? Because
yes,
well, it was a concern, not just on my part. Grave looks and hair and makeup in the morning. You guys know yours would be like brother and sister. Okay.
Well, that's what I was actually going to say. You're two of the only people I've seen pull off 1970s looks. You can do all this research for your character. You can know him inside out. What is it like to get on these sets that feel so real? Put on that hair, put on those clothes. How much does that help you find your character?
Very much so. And for it to be the 70s, so many of the movies that sort of make me want to act are the movies from that time period, because I think that they have what this movie has, which is it's about relationships. It's about, and there is wonderful hope in the movie, and there is wonderful optimism, even though. But the circumstances are so relatable, and the relationships are so relatable, and they're flawed. But that kind of authenticity and sort of permission to make movies like that, which I wasn't here in the 70s, but what I imagine is that that's just what it was like.
Yeah, thanks. I remember.
But really, it's these. Those are the movies that make me want to act, and they don't get made anymore. You feel like they don't get made. We would talk about that. Well, there's this story that we love, or this book that we love, and why can't this be a movie? Well, because there are no aliens, and there's no sort of incredibly high concept. You know, it's just a story about this relationship, or this family, or this. And so, you know, putting on the.
Yeah, I agree. It definitely helps. And George, also this production design is really helpful. The little details, you know, when you see the advertisements or what's on the TV or what, you know, all the props and stuff, you know how much of a difference that makes when people do that well and create that little environment for you to live in. The interesting paradox of the 70s, like as Lily alluded to, is that it's you could make an argument that it was the worst period in terms of taste for hair, clothes, and music, and the best for movies. I don't know why. That all the good ideas went into the filmmaking, and you know, the rest was polyester bell bottoms and like ironing your hair. But there were that. Those were the movies that I actually am almost exactly the age that the Daniels character is. And my father worked in a bar, and although I don't play his father, you know, this is very, very familiar to me. I remember all the cigarette machines and the who was, you know, all the baseball games and the standings and, you know, when I was that age. And so it was very, very familiar to me in a weird way, although I wasn't, I guess I was like maybe 2 years old and like quite, it was more, I guess like that, you know, the 80s I really remembered, that stuff. That was born in 72. But it was, it definitely felt startlingly authentic.
Yeah.
And brought me back to stuff I didn't even remember as a kid. And even though this is Long Island and where I grew up in Boston, you know, they think of themselves as very far apart from one another. They're actually almost identical, you know, and the same sort of people. And that was it brought back a lot of memories for me. Yes, all those details really, really helped.
Yeah. We do have time for a couple quick questions from the audience. If you have any, just raise your hand. We'll start right there.
I didn't notice and nobody asked me.
because Daniel's eyes are so dark brown,
mm-hmm.
and Ty is so light, so the first time you see him going to Yale on the train,
that's interesting. It wouldn't be a difficult thing to fix either. You know, there's a million effects houses that would do that, and that effect is probably not even that expensive. So it must have been the kind of thing that I would guess that it's just George or, you know, and Grant felt like, you know, you would just sort of go with it. I mean, I did.
tones, eye color. I find it really distracting. So I didn't even notice. You know, right here?
Thank you so much. It's such a lovely, lovely movie.
Thank you.
How do you like Beverly, Massachusetts?
Beverly, Massachusetts. Was that where you shot?
You know, I hadn't been to that. It was also not the Beverly, and I stayed in Belmont when I was there. It was interesting because I was in parts of Massachusetts that I had never ever been to once growing up there. You know, so it was sort of like going home, but also totally different. You know, some random suburb that. And when you work in a place, especially because George was kind enough to compress my time, as you see, I'm in part of the movie, and then I disappear for long stretches. And he put some of my work together so I could stop back and see my kids. So I was really just working and then going home, and I didn't do the tours.
Well, that bar is the bar exactly across the street from where I was brought up and born and raised.
Oh.
Yeah, there was a Chinese laundry there. It's now part of the YMCA building.
Huh?
But that was called the Lighthouse Bar. I used to go there and shoe shine.
Really?
For a quarter.
Did you meet Charlie?
What?
Did
you see Charlie? The bar was from the location where we're shooting.
Because I went back 3 months ago. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at the People magazine, and I see George, and it says the Tender Bar in Beverly. Then when I went back the summer, I met the bartender.
Oh.
Then 1,000 people showed up. But at the end of the movie, it shows my house.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, just before he gets in the car when he's leaving.
Yeah. I was actually going to say about that car, that must have really felt 70s driving that thing.
Those cars. Also the best movie. Movies and cars.
Yeah.
They're the greatest, America's peak.
I actually, it pained me when he gave the car away. I mean, it was a beautiful gesture, but it pained me.
I was kind of buzzed up about it. That was a really example of George. George's intelligence in terms of directing,
yeah.
Play the scene, and his really sharp instincts. Because every time I read that scene, you know, I cry, I just move me and I cry. And so, of course, I like come into the scene, like, here it is, the big scene, I'm gonna do it, make a thing. You know, I did it one take, and he was like, okay, I'm gonna get that scene. It's good, it's good, but it's not that fun. It's not even something like like he would say things that it would be, you just hate yourself for not realizing it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I guess, of course, I fucking mess up. That's exactly what
it
should be. Thank you. Don't keep talking. I know what to do. Please stop talking. And because so much of acting, you know, there's the talent and there's the ability to reproduce and access these emotions and do all this stuff. And there's also the imagination of a choice to make.
Yeah.
You know, and that to me is as much a part of it. And that's so a great director is just like a gift. There's so many gifts that George gave me, like in this movie that I look at, like that choice. You know, George, you know, and he's very quick, identifies them, and like, that's funny. Nope, that line's funny. And it totally changes everything. You realize exactly what it means, and you can see your whole character's backstory. You know, it's he's brilliant in that way. And it's the gift of working with a director who is an actor, because a lot of times you work with directors, they've just never done it before. Like, well, you have no sense of what it takes to be an actor, how you might be feeling, or what you might be thinking, you know. And, I'm sure I'll work with the director. Do the crying thing again. Oh, just that thing? Okay, yeah, I'll fire that back up. And George is the opposite of that. He creates this environment where you feel safe and comfortable and loose, and it's deliberate. And then his just working with somebody who's so good at doing the same job that I've been doing for, I don't know, quite a few years, it was just, I felt like I was stealing, you know. I felt like I feel guilty that it doesn't say, like, the, you know, by the performance by me and George's and her, really, because both contributed in equal measure to what I'm really proud of about the performance.
Can you let us know, is George bad at anything? Because I feel like I know better about myself to know.
Ben, you can let us know.
George is very gifted. That's true. He's very, and you know, it is infuriating because he's also a really good athlete. He was almost a pro baseball player. So he got off the softball thing, he's like, look at a few swings. Like, you're 60, dude. Why are you hitting the ball out of the park still? You know, and I can't believe this. And he's a very good athlete, very smart, very charming, very funny, very talented. I think he's been six categories. He's a remarkable guy. He really is.
And he has tremendous love for it. It's like this. There's no part of him that sort of has any kind of, which I think is what I love so much about playing this part, playing this family with him as the leader and the tone setter, and the, is that there's just no feeling of, he does not have this chip on his shoulder, there's no resentment, there's no heaviness. It's like there's this really genuine buoyancy that he has, and
particularly for actors, I feel like he loves actors.
Yeah.
He really said that his the fundamental identity was really shaped. Like the things he talks about the most is that period of time when he came to LA and was drug, you know, didn't he tried out for Cincinnati, the Reds. He almost made it, didn't quite make it as a pro ball, and it came out as a jock, you know what I mean? And so he sort of looked at the job, hey, it's a great job, we're lucky to be here. This is fun, I want to try to do it. And he experienced all this various versions of failure and rejection, a little bit of success, a little bit of rejection, not getting the part, you know, sleeping on people's couches. And that, I think, shaped his identity more than anything else. And so he just has and his friends are all actors, and he just has this deep regard and affection and affinity for actors, and you feel that on the set. Like, he just loves everybody that's there. And there's nothing you want more than, as an actor, honestly, you just feel like the director likes you. You know what I mean? They like you and kind of like what you're doing. You know what I mean? And like, you feel just like, okay, you know, you're starting from this baseline of being supportive, you know, rather than going over to the monitor and they're kind of like, yeah, I'm not sure what it is.
And there's trust, and he's not fearful. He's like never making, even if something shifts or changes, he's never making a decision from a fear-based place. And that is, that's just like freedom on set.
It's such a special movie. I love that you called it hopeful, because it doesn't even tell us at the end that he went on to be a Pulitzer Prize winning writer and, you know, everything that he's accomplished. We just sort of know. I want to, again, thank you so much for being here. I want to remind everyone